Now, the presentation for today's webinar is periodontal management of cardiovascular patient. So, the most important discussion is on the management of the cardiovascular patient. Now, cardiovascular patients are a group of patients which we come across very frequently, and then the most important rationale for the knowledge about cardiovascular patient is there are a large amount of patients who seek the periodontal care, and then we need to come across a lot of patients who have medical complications nowadays. So the most important thing about knowing them is the proper medical history. So we need to evaluate the proper medical history of the patient, then only we can get an update about the medical evaluation and medical status of the patient. Then first thing is what we need to know is the potential systemic conditions, and their evaluation can be done by American Society of Anesthesiologists, which is called as the ASA. ASA is the society which evaluates the physical state of the patient and give you a classification based upon its grading mechanism. They are a grading mechanism which ASA will give us. Now, when we consider ASA grade 1, we say the patients are considered to be normal and absolutely healthy. When we talk about the patients ASA 2, we say that these patients have mild to moderate systemic disease. These patients have mild to moderate systemic disease, and these patients are in fact little healthy only, but they have a little fear towards dentistry. ASA 3 are patients who have severe systemic disease that limits the activity but is not incapacitating. Then we have ASA 4, they have a severe systemic disease that limits the activity and is constant threat to life. So whenever possible, we have to go for elective dental care unless the patient has ASA 3. Then ASA 5 is the patients who are morbid and are not expected to survive more than 24 hours. That means patients who are under ventilation. Then we have ASA 6, which are declared clinically dead patients. And ASA E is an emergency operation of any variety which has to be done. So from this, what are we able to very clearly understand from this is all the patients according to the ASA are basically divided to understand that which patients are the candidate for the association. Now when we are dealing with the perio patients, we have to consider that. So considering that, the commentary is there in Journal of Periodontology 2008, which has given an implementation of ASA classification in periodontal practice. This is a very important article given by Maloney and Weinberg, 2008, which I want everyone to read once. But then it's the same classification, but then it will be giving you the details about it. Then you have got in 2008. Then the most important thing regarding the classification is we need to consider ASA 3. That is very important. We have to consider ASA 3. So, yeah, this is an important question for your practicals, that when you have a medically compromised patients, which patients are the candidates for the periodontal surgery, you have to answer ASA 3. The patient has to be worst case ASA 3, not more than that. You are not going to do the treatment. You are doing only the elective management. Then, when we deal with cardiovascular diseases, you have got various amount of diseases. And our actual management is the most common thing what we deal with the cardiovascular things. The most common thing is what exactly happens with these problems is the prevention of the bacterial endocarditis and dental management of cardiac patients. Now, when we consider dental management of cardiac patients, so the most important condition is hypertension. You have got ischemic heart disease, cardiac arrhythmias, congestive cardiac failure, valvular heart diseases, heart transplantation, and hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Now, when we deal with hypertension, hypertension is nothing but an increased blood pressure, but is considered as a silent killer. So the hypertension can be determined by knowing the systolic and the diastolic pressure. You have to refer the National High Blood Pressure Education Program and JNC 7 report. Now, this is the classification which I think you all are familiar to, but you have no time to read from Carranza. This is basically from Carranza, and we consider pre-hypertension to be 120 to 139, and then the diastolic supposed to be 80 to 89. Then you have got a stage 1 hypertension. We have got a stage 1 hypertension, and stage 1 hypertension has got a very important stage 1 hypertension. Then you have got stage 2 hypertensions. But what important is, when we commonly come across patients with stage 1 hypertension and there is no changes which are required for dental treatment, when it is stage 1. For stage 2 hypertension, it is 160 and more than 100. We are not going to do any treatment. We have to directly refer the patient when it is mostly diastolic more than 100. So please be very clear. The examiner may ask you, what is the criteria of not doing the surgery when patient is hypertensive? Your answer has to be more than 160 to 180. And the diastolic should not be more than 100. Diastolic more than 100 is dangerous, especially. So you have to go for only emergency care, and we are going to refer them to the medical. Then the most important thing to be considered under hypertension is, when are we going to recall the patient, and what is the protocol of recalling the patient? So there is something called as white coat hypertension, where patient gets fear and patient gets into hypertension, which is transient and happens on dental chair, which is very common. Then there are many physicians who are not knowledgeable about the specific procedures. You need to know that what is your procedure. Suppose you are doing a free gingival graft. Suppose you are doing a root coverage procedure. You are doing a CT graft. You know that your procedure is lengthy. You know that your procedure involves bleeding. So you know how much stress you are going to give the patient. So you need to know that if that amount of stress you're giving to the patient, what type of management you are going to do. The most important evidence is that we can go for an afternoon. Dental appointments are mostly preferred. And for the hypertensive patients, as it follows the circadian rhythm, their afternoon BP is little less. And you can go for a regular periodontal treatment. And for stage 3, you're not going to go for any of the procedures. Analgesics are prescribed for pain, and antibiotics are prescribed for infection. But mind you, there are literature which says that you are not going to give NSAIDs for more than 5 to 6 days for hypertensive patients, as it influences the blood pressure. So that is one important consideration. Second most important thing is the controversy regarding the hypertensive patients and epinephrine. You can clearly give epinephrine to patients and not greater than 1:1 lakh. Being very specific to you, all the cardiac patients, you can give epinephrine. And mind you, the concentration is not more than 0.04 milligrams epinephrine. 0.04 milligram epinephrine is the maximum dosage you can give to a patient of epinephrine to a patient of cardiac disorders. In patient with hypertensive disease, you have to also know that how do you minimize the pain. You have to give a very good profound local anesthesia which has got a profound epinephrine, but you are not going to cross. I hope you all know that epinephrine in a regular anesthesia, what you give as 2 ml lignocaine is 0.0125 milligram per ml. Then the clinician should be aware of many hypertensive, antihypertensive medications. You have got postural hypotension is very, very common and can be minimized by slow postural changes. Postural hypotension is very common side effect, and that is why we ask the patient to always be in a semi-supine position. Then these are the various drugs which are given, and you should know that the most common side effect with all the antihypertensive drugs the patient is taking is an orthostatic hypotension, which you can see here, and then you got a lot of dry mouth, and most important, you see a lichenoid reaction and nifedipine causing drug-induced enlargement. You should be very clear the conditions of the patient. Some patient, you may not notice, but patient may have lichen planus like reaction in the mouth, and you may write in buccal mucosa white lesion. Examiner may ask you, it is lichenoid reaction, which is attributed to antihypertensive drugs. That is one important finding. And orthostatic hypotension is very, very common. So how do you prevent it? By making the patient in a semi-supine position and changing the position of the patient frequently, and be very, very precise in doing your work. And especially angioedema is very common with captopril and enalapril, which is your ACE inhibitor. So you need to be aware of the antihypertension. And one more most important is xerostomia, which also happens. So these things, examiner will ask you that which antihypertensive patient is taking and what will happen. Next is ischemic heart disease. Ischemic heart disease, as you all know, is manifested by angina, which is stable, unstable, and by heart attack, which is your myocardial infarction. You have a stable angina, you can go for your treatment, but then you have to make sure that you need to wait after the last MI attack. You have to give a shorter appointments and make sure that your patient has lignocaine in it. Your patient amount of profound anesthesia, which you are giving to the patient, should have proper lignocaine and should have proper epinephrine, otherwise patient will have pain. So be very specific on that. Then you have got unstable angina, patient with unstable angina, you are not going to touch the patient, you will directly send the patient, they are not the candidate for the parenteral therapy, you have to defer the patient. And most important is preoperative anxiolytic agents. This is a very common, again, a question for chairside exam. What is the preoperative anxiolytic agent you give for a patient? Your answer has to be 5 to 10 milligrams of diazepam. 5 to 10 mg diazepam one day before the treatment, that is one night you can give the patient, and the 2 hours before the procedure, you need to give 5 to 10 milligrams of diazepam, or you can even give 0.5 or 0.25 milligrams of alprazolam. That is the drug of choice for an anxiolytic agent. This is again an important question. This is Levine sign, which is very common. When patient has an attack on chair, you may not be able to understand. Levine sign is the patient's hand or the fist, which is closed, the palm is closed, and then the patient has a radiation on the overall on the left side of the palm till the shoulder and the scapular region. That is Levine sign, which is very important. Then there is one study which has been done, and then the study has said that stress reduction protocol has minimized the epinephrine release and patient will be at maximum comfort. So what do we do when a patient has an ischemic attack is you need to follow 0.3 to 0.6 milligram of nitroglycerin to be given sublingually, reassure the patient and make sure that you need to have the oxygen which has to be there beside you or in the department, and make sure that the pain should subside within 3 minutes. You have to complete the procedure as soon as possible and try to give the patient every 3 minutes nitroglycerin, and you can give for 4 to 5 times, and still if pain doesn't subside, that means it's a declared sign of myocardial infarction, and then you have to go for emergency care. Maybe you have to go, you have to call the ambulance 108 and make sure that the patient is fine. But then you have to reassure the patient that patient will be fine, because basically it is because of very high stress patient gets a MI, and make sure that you are giving nitroglycerin. Is very common. And then if the patient gives you a history that I got an attack some 4 months back or 5 months back, you have to start your treatment only when 6 months of time lapse is given between the last attack and the procedures, especially for MI patients. You have got congestive heart failure. Congestive heart failure is again one condition where there is a heart failure and elective parenteral treatment to be delayed. Appointments have to be brief, and I've said to you, don't go for supine position for cardiac patients, go for a semi-supine position. And periodontist should be very alert of what is congestive heart failure. I guess you all know that congestive heart failure, the drug of choice is digitalis. We give digitoxin to patients, so you need to know the side effects, you need to know the toxicity, and you should be aware that what patient has and what disease and what drugs are patient taking. Then, a patient with a very poorly controlled congestive heart failure is usually not a candidate for elective therapy, but may receive conservative management. So short appointments, give sedation. Even sedation is a good drug of choice. You can also give patients sedation. But the only problem with conscious sedation is when you are giving sedation, it's difficult to do the maxillary quadrant surgeries. And you should be always aware that when you have an supplemental oxygen beside you, and that should be always there, but never happens. But then you have to be aware that these things are supposed to be there when you are dealing with such medically compromised patients. Then arrhythmias. I hope, again, arrhythmias is nothing but a type of a irregular heartbeat. It could be tachycardia, it could be bradycardia, it could be atrial fibrillation, it could be anything. Any irregular heart rate is arrhythmia, actually called as dysrhythmia. So some arrhythmias require pacemakers, which are mostly implanted transvenously. But the risk of patients for a unipolar pacemaker is this. I hope you all have read this as your undergraduation, that we do not do the scaling with myoprescriptive with this. Now the problem is, the pacemakers, I hope you know where pacemaker is kept. Pacemaker is actually kept below your skin subcutaneously, actually near your scapular region or below your clavicle region nowadays. And these pacemakers nowadays are given bipolar. Older days, last decade, they were given unipolar. So unipolar pacemakers, you have to avoid electromagnetic fields, which happens with especially electrocautery, and then your electric pulse testing, and even your apex locators, which work on electric conductance. So you need to know that the conductance system of the apex locators also work with electricity. So you need to avoid those things. But nowadays, we're giving bipolar, so you can proceed with the treatment, what exactly has to be given, and you can carry on with your treatment. There is no issue with that. Then the next most important thing when we deal with the arrhythmias is bipolar pacemakers. You can make sure that patient is already on bipolar, and then you can proceed with your treatment. And use of anesthesia with vasoconstrictors may be contraindicated for refractory arrhythmias, who are not responding to medical drugs. So you have to be very specific on that. And now comes the most important topic of discussion, which is infective endocarditis. Now, infective endocarditis, as you all know, is a very life-threatening condition involving the inner layers of the heart, where all the valves are involved. You know that there is something called as a vegetation formation, which you can see, which will form on the heart valves. Now, initially, before, it was called as bacterial endocarditis, but now it is called as infective endocarditis. Infective endocarditis can be subacute and acute. The most important thing is the bacteria. The organisms associated are Streptococcus viridans. You have got Staphylococcus, but for our concern is Hasek group of bacteria. I think everyone is familiar with Hasek group of bacteria. If you want, I'll just repeat. You can listen to Hasek. Hasek stands for Haemophilus species, which is H. A stands for Aggregative Bacter. C stands for Cardiobacterium. E stands for Echinella corridens. And K stands for Pingella kingae. So these are the five, and Hasek is the most important group of bacteria, which is a periodontal group of bacteria and also found in the infective endocarditis. Hasek is a very important Viva question. It's a theory Viva question. Then what are the controversies concerning infective endocarditis? This is given in period 2000, year 2000. I have given all the references underlying. You can see that. You have endocarditis from dental procedures. You need to know which patient is candidate for it. What is the invasiveness of the procedure? Choice of antibiotic, antimicrobial rinses, clinician, patient compliance, and window of infectivity. You should know that who is the candidate, who is at risk for this, for whom you're going to give the prophylaxis. Now, first, before that, you need to understand the bacteremia caused by perio procedures. And by dental procedures, as such, you have got tooth extraction. You have got 10 to 100% extraction bacteremia. SRP, 8 to 80%. Perio surgeries, 36 to 88%. And even rubber dam placement causes bacteremia. Now, this bacteremia with your regular tooth brushing, tooth pick usage, water irrigation, water pick or irrigators, chewing food and flossing. So, this also shows that bacteremia doesn't happen with the procedures also. Bacteremia also happens with the regular oral hygiene aids and the brushing also. So, you cannot prevent bacteremia, which is actually happening. So, this is the summary of the 9 iterations which happened. Now, you need to be clear that from 1955 to 1997, there were so many changes which happened. But then you need to follow, and all the changes, someone told give 1 gram, someone told you give 2 grams of amoxicillin, someone told you give 3 grams of amoxicillin, but you should know the current consensus as you are an exam going. So now for that, the previously you have got prophylaxis recommended for few patients and prophylaxis not recommended for few patients. So prophylaxis recommended for few patients will be a high risk patients and moderate risk patients. So in that you need to categorize that infective endocarditis history, prosthetic valves, congenital disease and valvular deficiency patients are the candidate for that. But then there are still modifications. I will rush to the slides for that. Then high category, as I said, is prosthetic cardiac valves. Please make sure previous bacterial endocarditis history, complex congenital heart diseases and pulmonary shunts and conduits are the patients. Patients with the history of MS, MR, ASIR, any valvular dysfunctions and mitral valve prolapse, and you may even add a patient with the cardiac transplantation or heart transplantation are the candidates for or undergoing. The most common authority on this topic is Rajani. Rajani was the person who has given in detail about the prophylaxis and relation to perio, AHA. Rajani is very important. It's Rajani et al. Who was given in American Heart Association also. Then you have got endocarditis high to moderate risk. Anything which involves blood, anything which does not involve blood, like your intracanal treatment, your endodontic treatment, your suture removal, your impressions, your fluoride, pit and fissure, taking X-rays, ortho, do not need prophylaxis. So being very clear, then heart views. There's a journal called as Heart Views 2007. You can see the reference there. Prosthetic heart valve conditions, previous history, congenital heart, I've been repeating again and again. Be very clear on the conditions. It's a very favorite question of every examiner that which patients are the candidate for infective endocarditis, and you need to answer that. Then the standard regimen. Standard oral regimen for amoxicillin is 2 grams 1 hour before the procedure. If the patient is allergic to amoxicillin, you can go for clindamycin, which is 600 milligram 1 hour before, or azithro, 500 milligram 1 hour before, or any cephalosporin. You can give 2 gram 1 hour before. If patient is not able to take amoxicillin orally, then you have to give ampicillin, which is 2 grams IM or IV within 30 minutes before the procedure. And if it is in the form of parenteral, then even clindamycin 600 milligrams. What commonly we give is amoxicillin 2 gram 1 hour before the procedure. Amoxicillin 2 gram, anabiotic oral ampicillin 2 gram IM or IV, or cefazolin 1 gram, or allergic to penicillin, clindamycin orally 600 milligram and azithromycin, clarithromycin 500 milligrams. Being very specific, this journal is Heart Views 2007. So one reference is 1997 Dajani, second reference is Heart Views 2007. Dental procedures which prophylaxis is reasonable is all the procedures which involve manipulation of gingival tissues or periapical teeth, region of teeth or perforation of the oral mucosa, you need to give the procedures. Now I come to the most important British Dental Journal 2016. The recent consensus is by NICE guidelines. NICE guidelines is a very, very important guidelines which gives you an antibiotic prophylaxis, which was given by Thornhill et al. So you have two associations. One is AHA, one is NICE. Okay, so NICE is also a National Institute for Clinical Excellence, and it gives you a clear guidelines in 2016, and that those guidelines have said that prophylaxis is not needed and not indicated. That is being very specific. Then I will lead to the controversy between the infective endocarditis prophylaxis, and the controversy is there are two things. Whether the bacteremia which is caused is itself very transient in nature. So it is cleared by the host innate and adaptive immune defenses. Then second thing is the dental procedures induced bacteremia does not pose risk for infective endocarditis. That means that whatever bacteremia is happening, it is cleared off by our immunity. And second thing is if there is bacteremia also, it does not pose that much high risk for infective endocarditis. That means it is not sufficient to cause the disease. So now when this topic comes, this is what are the two points given by NICE, and NICE said that we are not going to give the infective endocarditis prophylaxis. So you need to support. When you say you are not giving prophylaxis, you have to say the reference of NICE guidelines 2016, which is the recent guidelines what we have. Then how do you manage, how do you understand the periodontal management of these patients? Now you have an alternative regimen for the periodontal procedures. So if patient is on penicillins for secondary prevention of rheumatic fever or currently taking due to regenerative therapy. Now why are you giving penicillins? You may ask me that penicillins you are giving post-flap surgery. Everyone is behind giving penicillins post-flap surgery. You give penicillins after doing bone grafting or GTR. You give penicillins prescriptions for 3 times daily for 5 days. You are also giving penicillins 2 gram before that. Don't you think that patient will have a lot of issues with that? That is one thing. So patients with aggressive periodontitis who have a very high level of AA bacteria, Slots has given or suggested that you can give tetracycline 250 milligrams 4 times daily for 14 days. Then you give your conventional amoxicillin 2 grams prophylaxis. This is specially given for aggressive patients if you are doing plaque. Allow at least 10 to 14 days gap between appointments, because if you do the flap surgery weekly twice, you can't give the patient so much antibiotics. So you have to make sure that you give the antibiotic, you give the prophylaxis, and give a gap of at least 7 days between every appointment of your surgery. If not, you change the alternative regimen. Don't follow the same protocol, because you have to create other than being only discussing and clearing about giving only antibiotics to all the patients, and there is no choice other than that. You also need to understand that whenever we are dealing with these patients and trying to manage the patients, you also have to make sure that you are giving the antibiotics and patients are having resistance to it. Patients may have super infections, patients may have lot of issues. So you have to make sure that these patients are going to be not a candidate for antibiotic what you are giving, and you modify the antibiotic accordingly. Now, I will give you a few suggestive readings. There is a suggestive reading on circulation. This is 2007. I was talking to you regarding 2007 article on circulation. You have to quote this article of infective endocarditis on circulation 2007, which is from American Heart Association. There are two more. One is infective endocarditis rationale for revised guidelines in 2007 again, and in perio, especially volume 23, risk for endocarditis in dental practice by Lockhart, has given in detail about the prophylaxis and has given in detail about the controversies regarding endocarditis prophylaxis. You need to be very, very clear and understanding about this subject, because the most important thing there is one more book which I wanted you to understand, that periodontal disease and overall health, a clinical guide, is also one textbook on that. Okay, this is also one more book which is introduced based on this. So you can read this book also. It is online available, and maybe it is available in various departments also by Genco. This is a book which has given overall how do you manage. So I thank.